state bill makes sex illegal for teens. No sex for teens in Washington state.
Hey kids, come see us at the Fun Bus to Idaho. This is Cornell Hooper, and I've got buses leaving every hour for the state where it's still legal. Yes, Idaho is wide open and waiting. We'll take you across the state line and then look the other way. All for just $19.95. That includes tax, tips, and a souvenir Polaroid of your trip to Idaho. Get your reservations on the Fun Bus now. Remember, if you don't call today, you can't have sex tomorrow. Give us a call.
Tonight on Almost Live, Andy Kaufman and his giant frogs. Now, are we sure those frogs are here?
Yeah, they're here.
We've been plugging this the last couple of shows, yeah. And then they don't show up.
No, they're here. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm just kind of worried about them.
What's wrong?
Well, they don't look good.
Well, they're frogs.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And in just moments, they'll nuzzle up to this guy.
John.
Keister.
Thank you. Well, listen, everybody. They want to ban sex in our state. They want to ban sex. What kind of a state is this? You know, we've had the watering ban, the burning ban. We've had a ban on loud music, a ban on tinted windshields, and now they want to ban sexual contact between consenting minors. Now, some fraternity brothers at the UW want to know if that includes livestock. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. You know, all this talk has started a frenzy of restrictive legislation. They're banning things all over the state. For example, the city of Kent has banned all sideburns of less than 3 inches. Auburn bans all cars that don't have bumper stickers saying honk if you're horny. Tacoma's Hilltop neighborhood bans drive-by shootings between the hours of 4 and 6 p.m. On Broadway, there's a ban on any person whose hair and clothes are not making a serious statement. In White Center, there's a ban on residents who say they live in West Seattle. The University of Washington bans all fraternities that order an inordinate amounts of Crisco and peanut butter. And the Tacoma Dome bans any event that doesn't involve monster trucks. And there is a statewide ban on guys who go, oh, at concerts. You know, we think that things may be getting out of hand with all these bans, but don't let that give you the impression that we here at Almost Live are soft on crime. No, not us. And to prove it, we now present another episode of our physically fit superhero for the 90s. Ladies and gentlemen, stand by for Speedwalker.
The reporter, Jeff Bimmel. The story, Seattle's ever-changing skyline. And what better place to view it than Seattle's most famous landmark, the Space Needle. Even on a blustery day, from up here, the city looks serene, secure, safe. But then, my God, someone's trying to steal the Space Needle. I've got to do something. How long does it take for the elevator to get all the way down?
41 seconds.
I'm sorry, ma'am, that's just not fast enough. This looks like a job for... Speedwalker.
Yes, it's Speedwalker, a physically fit superhero who fights crime while maintaining strict adherence to the regulations of the International Racewalking Association. Heel toe, heel toe, Speedwalker.
Thank you.
bitch, punk! Your Space Needle Bolt Burglar.
Thank you, Speedwalker.
If you'll excuse me, I have some nuts to retorque. Good as new. Remember, kids, respect your landmarks and always heel toe, heel toe.
Speedwalker!
Okay, stay with us. We'll be right back. We have Giant Frog! Giant Welcome to the pre-game show for the big one, Super Bowl 24.
Now, the Super Bowl is widely known as the most boring 3 hours in sports, but it doesn't have to be.
Wagering on the game always adds a little excitement, but since everyone knows that in this year's game, Denver is going to be utterly humiliated and broken, most serious gamblers say the best action will be the Bud Bowl.
Now, last year, Bud beat Bud Light 27-24.
This year, Jimmy the Greek says it'll be Bud again by 7 points. Jimmy says that Bud Light can never win because Bud has bigger thighs.
Now, the game, as everybody knows, is being played this year in New Orleans between San Francisco and Denver. But as Lou Gelas tells us, even that's not carved in stone. Lou?
Well, the whole nation is looking forward to the Super Bowl on Sunday, but here in Seattle, we're especially interested because of the mathematical possibility that the Seahawks could still qualify for the big one in New Orleans. Here's what has to happen. First of all, it starts with the Denver Broncos, 12, 13-point underdogs, and clearly headed for their fourth Super Bowl loss. The team is depressed, and there's a chance that they could spend too much time drinking and carousing on Bourbon Street. They wake up Sunday too ill to perform. This would put the AFC runner-up Cleveland Browns into the picture. However, if there were to be a major snowstorm in Ohio, severe enough to knock down phone lines, which could happen, there would be no way to notify the Browns in time. So the AFC semifinalists, Pittsburgh and Buffalo, would be next. Now, let's assume that the plane carrying the Steelers accidentally flies into Soviet airspace and is shot down, and the Bills' entire team is sidelined by one of those 24-hour bugs that's been going around, which could happen, and we come to Houston then, the team which recently fired its coach, Jerry Glanville. They, of course, are in total disarray and are not organized enough to field a team. This brings us to Cincinnati, which, being in Ohio, is also crippled by that big snowstorm. Next in line would be the Los Angeles Raiders. But the big problem here is that Bo Jackson has already started preparing for baseball spring training. And if he can't play, why would the Raiders bother? That leaves Kansas City, Miami, and the Seahawks. Well, let's assume that half of Kansas City's team has signed up for that fun cruise with Brian Bosworth, which could happen. That would eliminate them. This leaves Miami and Seattle. Now, these two teams did not play against each other during the regular season. However, since Seattle was recently voted the most livable city in America, not Miami, the Seahawks would have the edge and would therefore qualify as San Francisco's opponent for the Super Bowl, which could happen.
Okay, but no matter who plays, the real stars of any Super Bowl are the commercials. And this year, at $1.4 million a minute, the competition is fierce. The advertisers have pulled out all the stops, so let's preview the action.
A new McDonald's ad filmed in a small town in Alaska will promote the new Quarter Pounder with crude, McBlubber with cheese, and Otter McNuggets.
We'll all be anxiously awaiting the new Pontiac commercials. They'll be unveiling a brand new version of Ride Pontiac Ride with new music. Maybe something like Ride Pontiac Ride.
There's a new Pepsi ad with the Wonder Years' Fred Savage, who writes a love letter comparing his love for Pepsi to his love for a certain girl. Apparently she's cold, cheap, and completely unnatural.
And Gillette is introducing a revolutionary new razor during the Super Bowl. Now, you have to wonder, how revolutionary can a razor be? Well, initial scouting reports say that the razor may work in one of three ways. One, low-level radiation rods actually vaporize the 5 o'clock shadow into oblivion.
Two, a tiny digital voice module criticizes each whisker, crushing its self-esteem until it simply gives up and falls out on its own.
Or three, the handheld unit actually faxes unwanted facial hair to another location.
So there should be plenty of excitement during Super Bowl 24. Just don't look for it on the football field.
Finally, we want you to feel as comfortable as possible as you watch the game. So here are a couple of phrases that you will hear the announcers saying.
That could be the play of the game right there.
This could be the play of the game right here.
Now, here are some phrases you won't hear the announcers saying.
Oh, this victory has got to feel good for Denver.
What San Francisco really needs is a quality linebacker like Brian Bosworth.
And finally, here are some phrases you'd like to hear the announcers saying.
Why would a major network give a microphone to a jerk like me?
I'm sorry, have I been babbling?
That halftime show really sucked.
Hey, Madden, what were you staring at in the locker room?
Uh-oh, Pat. Those nachos are coming back on me.
Well, we hope that helps. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the bleachers.
Good night.
Studio amplification for Almost Live provided by American Music.
Okay, we're back. We're back. Thank you. Well, if you own a television or read any newspaper in the world, you're probably familiar with my next guest tonight. He's the center of a huge controversy involving the world's biggest frog jumping contest because he owns the world's biggest frogs. Please welcome Andy J. Frogman Kaufman. Come on out.
Nice to have you here.
This is the guy. You're the guy we've all been reading about. You know, I feel a strange kinship with Andy also. Andy, before just a little bit of background before we get the frogs out. You lived for 12 years in Cameroon, the African country of Cameroon. I believe we've got a picture of that there, the people that you live now. What's wrong with this picture? There he is.
Can you tell where I am, Dan?
Yeah, the outside. You lived with that tribe, is that right?
I spent nine years with those people.
9 years with those people, and that's where you discovered these frogs, is that correct?
That's correct. I discovered these frogs.
Yeah. And you're the only person in the world who has them.
Absolutely the only person in the world that has them.
Okay.
Except for a few Cameroonians.
Right. And you've brought them here because you import these sort of animals and things in. And a big controversy has sprung up about this. We'll talk about it a little bit later. But I think, can we bring them out and start hand? Can I pick
sure.
up one? Can I
okay.
handle one?
Okay, incidentally, John has never handled this frog yet. This ought to be fun. We'll try a little one to begin with.
Okay. All right. This is a little one. Whoa!
Now what you do, John, is you just hold them like that. You see how I'm holding them between
them? Yeah. Okay.
Right in there, kind of tight though.
Yeah.
So you don't drop them.
Okay.
You got them? Hold them tight. There.
Okay, that doesn't hurt him?
No,
that's
it
okay. It's like my kids. This is the way I hold my kids. Yeah, that's the same thing.
Isn't that good?
Now,
and that's an 8-pound, 3-ounce frog, which makes it, according to Guinness, the largest frog in the world.
But this is a small one to you.
I told Guinness they'd never been to Cameroon. They grow to 15 pounds.
Well, that's amazing. And once you were seen on The Tonight Show with these, you've got a lot of response. Michael Jackson, you're going to go down and see him on Thursday.
It's just been overwhelming, yes.
Yeah, okay. How much are you going to charge Michael Jackson for this little guy?
So far we only sell them to zoos. If we do decide to sell some to Michael Jackson, we sell them for $2,500
each. $2,500
each,
and you're going to be bringing some more in there. And now I can understand where you are going to enter these in the famous Calaveras County. Frog.
My intentions are to shatter the
world record. Why don't you take him there for a while? Okay. And I know there's a lot of controversy there. You want to shatter the world's record.
I'm going to shatter the world's record.
Delightful odor. These frogs have a delightful odor.
You know, people say you get warts from them. No, what you do to frogs, John, is you kiss them and they turn into princes.
That's okay. I'll let you take care of that. That's fine. But now, the local paper, I guess, around the Calaveras area is printed. I think we've got an editorial cartoon there. Maybe, let's see.
Yes.
Sure, he would have won if the what does that say? If only he hadn't eaten the judges, he would have won. Something like that. There's a bit of a controversy there because, like, I think we've got a picture also of the current national champion. That's the.
That's my competition.
That's your competition there. Okay.
Yes,
and so they, of course, think. Wow, they think this is a bit of you're using ringers here, it's a bit
of
a... Well,
they think my frogs are too big, and...
What do you say to that when people... I mean, don't they have a point that this is sort of bringing
I understand what they're saying, but this is a contest. The Guinness World Book of Records will be there. It's a contest to measure the largest, longest jump of three jumps of a frog.
Uh-huh.
The rules are that the frog be at least 4 inches and be a frog. This certainly is 4 inches, and it definitely is a frog.
Okay.
And so I'd like to... And besides, I feel it's the destiny of these frogs to win that contest.
Okay. And so, we're going to have them jump here in just a minute. What is the world's record down there right now?
Calaveras County, the world's record is 21 feet, 5 3/4 inches, but that's measuring from the beginning of the first jump to the end of the third jump.
So three jumps, and they go 20 feet or so. And how long can these guys jump?
Mine can jump 20 feet in one jump. but probably not. It could jump 3 feet. It could jump 10 feet. It could jump 20 feet. The thing is, they could start from the starting point and then jump and end up at the starting point. If that was the case, they wouldn't win. But we have 10 frogs. We have a good shot at it.
Okay, well, let's see. Let's get some of these guys here. Yeah,
we'll just get one that's a little bit fresh.
Okay. Do you need your assistance or anything?
They're going to watch us. We want to make sure.
Bring them right out.
We want to watch the audience here. When a frog jumps up, just catch it.
Just grab him, yeah. You see the way, you already know how to hold it. Whoa, whoa. What's that? Don't spook them now. Don't scare them.
Okay,
They jump at people who scream.
Okay, here we go. It's just going to be one jump. One, two, three, jump.
Oh, look at me.
You want to be careful with that.
Don't hurt.
Oh. Okay.
Oh, don't.
He's okay. Grab him.
Oh, there. Well, we've lost a frog in the studio, ladies and gentlemen.
That was one frog. We'll put him back here, Scott. We'll take another frog. We'll try it one more time here.
Wow, that's...
If you'd like to do that.
Really something. Boy, that's really something. Now, what do they eat? I mean, would these guys eat...
These frogs are opportunistic. They'll eat anything that moves. We feed them goldfish, mice.
Could they eat another one of the frogs down there?
They could, but, that's getting a little bit... They're very timid and shy as far as eating goes. You never see them eat.
Okay, let's see if we can get a shot of this guy going.
Two, three, boom!
Oh!
Okay, let's take this guy.
There we are. Oh, yeah. Good shot.
Thank you.
That's a good shot.
Thank you.
Well, Andy, that's very impressive, and I know that you've got right here this T-shirt. You're opening up a training... Andy is opening a training center for his frogs here
in Seattle. People of Seattle, we want to build a training facility to teach these frogs to jump. And we have these T-shirts that support the... Support
Andy Kaufman's Frog Training Center. You're trying to raise money for that, and you'll let the public in to see the frogs training.
Absolutely.
Because the record's going to come home to Seattle.
That's right.
Thanks very much for coming.
Thank you, John, very much. Thank all of you.
If you saw our show last week, you witnessed a truly historic event, the introduction of our fabulous 70s Challenge. It's a three-part contest that could win you a trip to Los Angeles to watch a taping of The Tonight Show with Jay Leno or maybe even Johnny. In a minute, we'll give you this week's question, but first, here's the first question from last week. In the 70s, pukas, A, drove barracudas and drank Schlitz, B, hung around your neck, or C, grew wild in Northern California. Okay, that was last week. Now here's this week's question. It's a fill-in-the-blank. Fill-in-the-blank with the correct word to this lyric from a Peter Frampton song. Woke up this morning with a blank in my hand. You got it? Okay, well now, when you finish that, just, you know, we'll give you the next question next week. You can send it in and you may win that. That's our fabulous 70s challenge. That's all the time we have this week. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Promotional consideration for Almost Live provided by Pizzeria Polanyi, featuring traditional and gourmet pizza by the way. Pizzeria Polanyi, rated Seattle's best pizza. Promotional consideration also provided by your local Coca-Cola bottlers.